Good morning, all of you. Today I will be discussing pleura. As you can see from this picture, pleura is the outermost covering of the lung. It's a delicate and closed serous sac into which corresponding lung is invaginating from the medial side. So pleura has two layers. The outermost covering is parietal pleura, and the inner covering, which is closely investing the lung tissue, is visceral pleura. Between the parietal and visceral pleura, we have a space which is called as pleural cavity. Now, this is a small embryological slide which helps us to understand, like, during the embryological development from endoderm, you will see the formation of laryngotracheal tube, from where two lung buds are formed and they are invaginating into the coelomic cavity. So the coelomic cavity, which is closely covering the lung bud, will be transforming into the visceral pleura, and the cavity which is lining away is converted into the parietal pleura, and in between them, whatever space is enclosed is the pleural cavity. Here also two different colors have been used to show the pleura. Outer lining, red in color, is the parietal pleura. Inner layer, blue in color, is visceral pleura, and in between them, the free space is the pleural cavity. So below the visceral pleura, we have the lung tissue. Now, the parietal and the visceral pleurae are separated by pleural cavity. Usually, the clinicians use the term pleural space, anatomists use the term pleural cavity, which is filled with pleural fluid. The normal amount is 10 to 20 ml. This fluid permits two layers to move on each other with minimum friction. Now, visceral pleura is also called as pulmonary pleura, and this is the pleura which is shown in blue color, and it is closely investing the lung tissue. And it is entirely investing the lung except at this place, which is called as the hilum, and the attachment of the pulmonary ligament, which will be the reflection of parietal pleura. And it is extending into the depths of interlobar fissures. As you can see here, these are the interlobar fissures. It is firmly adherent and cannot be separated from lung. Now, based on the place where it is present, if it is present below the ribs, we call it as costal pleura. If it is resting on the diaphragm, we call it as diaphragmatic pleura. If it is like extending into the neck region, we call it as cervical pleura. And the one which is entering like behind the sternum and in front of the vertebral column, that is mediastinal area, you call it as mediastinal pleura. Now, the same thing is shown. Now here we have cervical pleura, which is the parietal pleura, which is protruding into the root of the neck. Costal pleura is lining under the surface of the ribs, costal cartilages, intercostal muscles, and back of the sternum. Diaphragmatic pleura is the pleura which is resting on the upper surface of diaphragm. Mediastinal pleura is the pleura which is covering the mediastinal surface of the lung. Now, costal pleura is this one, which is extending from the inner surface of the ribs and the costal cartilages, intercostal spaces, and then it comes back to the side of the vertebral column. Now, if from this picture, this pink line is indicating like the anterior aspect, you have sternum, posterior aspect, we have vertebral column, and this is the transverse section, which is taken at around fourth thoracic vertebra. You can see this pink line extending from the sternum below the ribs up to the vertebral column. This is the costal pleura, and the one which is towards the mediastinum on the posterior aspect of the sternum till the posterior anterior aspect of the vertebra, you call this as mediastinal pleura. Now let us see tracing of this costal pleura. It's very, very important. We should know, like, it is extending like from the back of the sternum. This is also called as pleural reflection. Pleural reflection itself is a very important question, which can come as an essay or FIMOX question for university exam. So we can see when you start tracing, like it is, we have to start it from the back of the sternum, continuous with the mediastinal pleura, along the posteromediastinal line of reflection. And it is on both the sides, that is the right and left side. See, this is right pleural reflection, this is left pleural reflection. So it is extending downwards and medially from sternoclavicular joint to middle of the sternal angle, sternoclavicular joint to the middle of the sternal angle. Then both the sides, we can see the pleura is moving up to the fourth costal cartilage. So the pleural reflection from the sternoclavicular joint to the fourth costal cartilage is same both on the right side and left side. Now, so you can see this is exclusive picture which shows us from the sternoclavicular joint, then sternal angle, then till the fourth costal cartilage, the right pleural and left pleural reflections are same. Now, when you observe on the right side, the pleural reflection is continuing and it is vertically, so you can see it is going downwards, okay, behind the Zeffy sternal joint. This is the blue line we are supposed to follow. Zeffy sternal joint follows the seventh costal cartilage and it is now becoming continuous with the costodiaphragmatic reflection of the pleura. Okay, so it is taking a bend at seventh costal cartilage and it is continuing with costodiaphragmatic line of pleural reflection. Now left side, if you observe, it is deviating. When you see left lung, it will have cardiac notch. So in accordance with the cardiac notch, we will see this side we have like a bend which is starting at fourth costal cartilage where it is descending downwards close to the sternum and extending up to the sixth costal cartilage. Then again it is turning laterally as costodiaphragmatic line of pleural reflection. Now, this is the picture which is seen from behind. When you see it from behind, you will see like we have traced it till here. Now, you are continuing like this. Now, it is continuous with the mediastinal pleura by the side of the vertebral column, both the sides of the vertebral column. So, it is extending 2.5 centimeters lateral to the 7th cervical spine and 2.5 centimeters lateral to 12th thoracic, 7th cervical and extending up to 12th thoracic spine. So this is the pleural reflection behind, which is same for both the lungs, right and left parietal pleural reflection. Now when you see above, that is covering the apex of the lung, it is the cervical pleura which is aligning along the inner border of the first rib. Now when you see below, it is continuous with the diaphragmatic pleura. On the right side, we know it is starting with the Zeffy sternal joint, this point. Then it is moving to the 8th costal cartilage. This point is corresponding to the midclavicular line. Then it is going to the 10th rib, which is corresponding to the midaxillary line, 10th rib. Then it 2.5 centimeters lateral to the 12th thoracic spine, it comes like this. Okay, that is the right pleural reflection below, parietal pleural reflection. Left parietal pleural reflection, we know like from the 6th costal cartilage, then the further reflection is same, that is 8th costal cartilage in midclavicular line, 10th rib in the midaxillary line, then 2.5 centimeters lateral to 12th thoracic spine, that is inferiorly. Now, if you observe this picture, the pink thing is actually the right and left lung and blue thing is the pleura. So, the lower border of the lung is little higher up when you compare with the lower border of the parietal pleura. How much it is? Let us see. So, when you measure, when you see at the midclavicular line, we know the parietal pleura is corresponding to 8th rib. But correspondingly, the margin of the lung will be 6th rib in the midclavicular line. Now we know like the parietal pleura in the midaxillary line, it is corresponding to 10th rib. Correspondingly, the lung midaxillary line, it will be corresponding to 8th rib. Now when you see behind, the margin of the parietal pleura, midscapular line is corresponding to the 12th rib. But correspondingly, midscapular line of the lower border of the lung is corresponding to the 10th rib. Now coming to the diaphragmatic pleura, the one which is lining the diaphragm, this is all diaphragmatic pleura, covers the thoracic surface of the corresponding part of the diaphragm. Laterally it becomes continuous with the costal pleura along with the costodiaphragmatic line. Medially it becomes continuous with the mediastinal pleura and where it takes continuity with the attachment of the fibrous pericardium of the heart and central tendon of diaphragm. Now, cervical pleura is this one which is covering the apex of the lung, which is covering the first rib, from the inner border, and we can see its projection. It is downwards and medially, and it is continuing with mediastinal pleura. Summit, if you want to measure it from the costal cartilage, from the first rib, it will be measuring around 3 to 4 centimeters. And when you want to measure from the clavicle, it will be 2.5 centimeters above the sternal end of the clavicle. So the upper part of the parietal pleura, at the cervical pleura, it is covered with a special membrane which is called as suprapleural membrane or Sipson's fascia. What is this Sipson's fascia? See, this is dome-shaped musculofacial expansion. Behind it is attached to the tip of the transverse process of the seventh cervical vertebra. In front, it is attached to the inner border of the first rib. Medially, it is continuous with the pretracheal fascia, what we have studied in head and neck. Now, function of this suprapleural membrane or Sipson's fascia is, it is protecting the apex of lung and cervical pleura from the structures of the root of the neck, and it is also resisting the intrathoracic pressure during respiration. As a result, root of the neck is not puffed up and down during respiration. We know it is musculofacial expansion, so muscular part is derived from the muscle scalenus minimus, facial part is derived from endothoracic fascia. Now, coming to the mediastinal pleura, this is the root of the lung, and it is described, mediastinal pleura is described subdivided into three: above the root of the lung, at the root of the lung, and below the root of the lung. And mediastinal pleura is forming lateral boundary of mediastinum. Now, coming to the above the root of the lung, it is an anteroposterior sheet which is extending from the sternum to the vertebral column. Now, on the right side, this mediastinal pleura, on the right side above the root of the lung, we have these structures. What are these? We are finding the brachycephalic vein, right brachycephalic vein, then superior vena cava, arch of the zygous vein, then right phrenic nerve, then right vagus, trachea, and esophagus. Left side, above the root of the lung, the mediastinal part of the pleura is related to arch of aorta, then left common carotid artery, left brachycephalic and superior intercostal vein, then left phrenic, left vagus, and recurrent laryngeal nerve, trachea, and esophagus. Along with that, we also see thoracic duct. Now, at the root of the lung, if you observe, this blue line is indicating parietal pleura, green line is indicating visceral pleura. The parietal and visceral pleura become continuous at the hilum. Okay, so at the lung root, it passes laterally in the form of a tube enclosing the structures in the lung root at the margin of the hilum. It is becoming continuous with visceral pleura. Now, below the root of the lung, both the layers, like the two layers of the parietal pleura, are fusing and they are forming one ligament, which is called as pulmonary ligament, which is extending from the side of the esophagus to the corresponding lung below the hilum. So, tracing above, both layers are separating to enclose the lung root. Tracing below, both are fused to form a free margin which stands vertically. Clearly, it is standing above the diaphragm. Now, this is the pulmonary ligament. This is also the pulmonary ligament. So, pulmonary ligament contains loose areolar tissue and lymphatics. This is the lung root, which is actually allowing the structures to enter and exit outside and the lung. Then the pulmonary ligament is actually a collapsed portion of the same sheet. It is devoid of all these important structures. So the importance of this pulmonary ligament is, whenever there is increased venous return, like in the pulmonary vein, this is an extra space where the venous expansion can take place. So it is acting as a dead space. Now, apart from this, we are also having the recesses of pleura. So, recesses are nothing but the extra spaces. You see, towards the mediastinum, we have one recess which is called as mediastinal recess, and towards the diaphragm we have one recess which is called as costo-diaphragmatic recess. So now we know the visceral pleura is closely investing the lung. So this becomes the visceral pleural layer and this becomes the parietal pleural layer. Between the visceral pleura and parietal pleura, the empty space is the pleural cavity. And here the space is quite big and it is enclosing a very wide space which is actually called as costo-diaphragmatic recess. Similarly, towards the mediastinum, we have a recess which is called as costo-mediastinal recess. So normally the space between the visceral and the parietal pleura is a potential space which is filled with thin film of serous fluid. In areas of pleural reflection on the diaphragm and mediastinum, the space between the parietal and visceral pleura is greatly expanded. That is the pleural recess. Essentially, it is the space where lungs can expand during deep breathing. So costo-diaphragmatic recess is right and left, 2 in number. Costo-mediastinal recess is also right and left, 2 in number. Now, costo-diaphragmatic recess is the one which is lower down, which is slit-like potential space between the costal and diaphragmatic parietal pleurae. Lower limit of the pleura is corresponding to 8th, 10th and 12th ribs in midclavicular, midaxillary and midscapular planes respectively, which correspond to the lower border of the lung corresponding to 6th, 8th and 10th ribs, which I have shown in the form of table in my previous slide. This is the costo-diaphragmatic recess. Now, so we know like lateral profile, this is a semilunar widest midaxillary line. Lower border of the lung lies 5 centimeters above the lower limit of the pleura, which allows the free expansion of the lung in deep inspiration. So it is the most dependent part of the pleural sac, hence fluid of the pleural effusion tends to collect here. So this part is costo-mediastinal recess, which is located anteriorly between the costal and mediastinal pleurae, and it lies between the sternum and costal cartilage. Right costo-mediastinal recess is occupied by the right anterior margin of the right lung and even during void breathing. Left costo-mediastinal recess is large due to the presence of cardiac notch in the left lung. Its location can be confirmed clinically by percussion, that is tapping of the chest wall, as one moves during tapping from this area of underlying lung tissue to the area to the left. Costo-mediastinal recess unoccupied by lung tissue, a change in tone from resonant to dull is noted. That means we see dull note on the left costo-mediastinal recess. This area is called as area of superficial cardiac dullness. So after this, let us know the nerve supply of the pleura. Parietal pleura, embryologically, it is developed from somatopleuric layer of the lateral plate of mesoderm. Hence, it is supplied by somatic nerves. Hence, it is sensitive to pain. Costal and peripheral part of the diaphragmatic pleura are supplied by intercostal nerves. Mediastinal and central part of the diaphragmatic pleura are supplied by phrenic nerves. This, from this picture also we can understand. Then visceral pleura develops from splanchnopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm, hence supplied by autonomic sympathetic nerves T2 to T5. Hence it is insensitive to pain. Referred pain is the pain which is felt away from the point of its origin because both the areas will be sharing the same dermatomal development. So pain from central diaphragmatic pleura and mediastinal pleura is referred to the neck or shoulder through phrenic nerves, root value C3, C4, C5. Because skin of these sides has same segmental supply through the supraclavicular nerves. Blood supply of the pleura. Parietal pleura is supplied by intercostal arteries, internal thoracic artery and musculophrenic artery and drained by the same veins. Visceral pleura is supplied by bronchial vessels. Now coming to the lymphatic drainage, cervical pleura is draining into axillary nodes. Then this mediastinal pleura is draining into parasternal nodes. Diaphragmatic pleura is draining into phrenic nodes. Costal pleura is draining into intercostal nerves. Visceral pleura is draining into bronchopulmonary lymph nodes, which will be draining into the hilum of lung. Coming to the clinical anatomy, pleuritis is the inflammation of the pleura, and we know parietal pleura is sensitive to pain because it is derived from somatopleuric layer of the mesoderm. So usually we find such pain in pulmonary tuberculosis, and the pain becomes worse whenever there is more accumulation of fluid in the pleural fluid, which leads to friction, and we will feel this in the form of pleural rub, and we can hear this with the help of stethoscope. Now, in case we know, like, normally the pleural cavity is filled with pleural fluid, which is around 10 to 20 ml. But suppose if it is increased, you call this condition as hydrothorax. If it is filled with air instead of fluid, you call it as pneumothorax. If blood is filling, then we call it as pneumothorax. If pus is filling, it is called as pyothorax, also called as empyema. You can see in case of pleural effusion, lot of fluid has got accumulated in the pleural space. More than 10 to 20 ml, it may go up to 100 ml also, or more than that. So this condition is called as pleural effusion. So in case of pleural effusion, what is happening? The negativity of the pleural pressure will be less, and because of which there will be improper expansion of the corresponding lung, and the lung will collapse of that particular side. The lung is compressed. So usually we do pleural tap by inserting the needle between 9th and 10th intercostal space. So, and we should see that needle is close to the upper border of the rib, because we know towards the lower border of the rib we have the costal groove with wand structures, intercostal vein, intercostal artery and intercostal nerve. So to protect that, we should do the insertion of needle close to the upper border of the rib. Usually, preferably between 9th and 10th intercostal space in mid-axillary line. So this procedure is called as pleural tap, also called as thoracentesis, in order to aspirate the excess fluid present in the pleural cavity. Of course, it should be followed with good antibiotic treatment, otherwise again the fluid will start getting collected. There is a condition where if air is filling into the pleural cavity, you call it as pneumothorax, which will reduce the negativity in the pleural space, which will cause the inexpansion of that corresponding lung, leading to the collapse of that particular lung. Open pneumothorax is when the air is entering from outside into the pleural cavity. Here also negativity will be reduced, leading to the lung collapse. Usually we see such things in stab injuries, tension pneumothorax, again chest wounds. Now, pyothorax is the accumulation of pus in the pleural space of the pleural cavity. Thank you.